is very hard. Okay, let's get back. So we are talking about Amrita. Okay, I was talking about, you know, you do a lot of things in your life, of which some skills are part. Maybe you read Bhagavad Gita, or you teach Bhagavad Gita, you recite a shloka, you recite, you know, very many people do Narayaniyam or Vishnu Sahasranamam. That it's there in every aspect of your life, or lot many aspects of your life. It's very, very difficult to get away from it. Now, knowing that language, I was trying to illustrate from Bhagavad Gita. One aspect, I mean, as I told you, Bhagavad Gita is there, survived, because, not only because of its beautiful content, the power of the content, but also the ease of the language. You can fairly easily read Bhagavad Gita and understand it.
Yeah.
Except for you look at it and say, I don't know Sanskrit, and you start reading it, you will not know. For a moment, if you discard that notion that I don't know Sanskrit and start looking at it, a lot of it will be understandable. Now, I was telling you, you read the first, you know, you read it yourself. You virtually go to Kurukshetra. You can see the feet. You can see the way they're doing. Like this man says, hey, ratam stapa yame chuda. And that man collapses. Satum na cha shaknomi. All that you feel, if you know with the language.
Oh, yes. With feeling.
You feel it. Oh, arshancha jayate. As you are reading it, you will feel it. You will feel it.
Okay.
And Sambodhan is so important. You can see whenever Krishna starts respectfully, like Bharata Rishabha, I don't have to see the next sentence. I know because he's going to hit Arjuna.
Yeah.
He starts the most respectful of Sambodhanam. Like one, Nimitta Matram Bhava Savya Sachin.
Yeah.
You know what the word Savya Sachin means? Somebody who can shoot an arrow with both the left hand, ambidextrous.
Yes.
Okay, both the left hand and the right hand. The Bhagat, you can shoot the arrow with both arms. That doesn't mean a thing. You are only Nimitta Matram. I decide. These are things I think you experience when you kind of, I mean, you don't need somebody between you and the battle, or you and Krishna. You kind of, that's true of several things. For example, I've seen in Margari, in the month of Margari, people go to the temple, wake up early, go and recite Tirupavai, they recite Godasudhi. And that man, Vedanta Desikan, has done such a beautiful prati. So esoteric, so beautiful. He'll quickly recite, go and collect our pongal and go away. Find something like this. You are putting so much of effort learning it, getting it by heart. You need a little more effort. You need a little multiplier for it to become something very, very big. For example, I know, it will be in a temple and Gopal Ramshti will be recited. I would recite 3 slokas and stop. And this lady Vijayaka, Kumar, I'll get so completely lost in the meaning of that. I would not move to the 4th sloka at all. So that is the great enjoyment that's available with a little effort in terms of Sanskrit. Therefore, to answer Keshav's point, is it Amrita? Yes. Amrita in the sense, it touches 1, 2, 3, 4. If you come to a little later, it is there in yoga, it is there in the Ayurveda, it is there in multiple things. So the first point is, it's an Amrita. Second point, the connotation that is there is always, like I used to work for a company which got into some trouble. They'll say, Kumar, your company is so technically good. I know the next thing that they're saying, but you vagas, you are not managing it well. Okay. Yeah. So the moment you say it's Amrita, then you say it's Amrita, but you see it's not available for me. It's not reachable for me. Now, we should learn to look at it. I don't know whether you intend that way or not, as a metaphor. The way you talk about Amrita is what? There's a lot of churning. Do you understand my point?
He
turned the Milky Ocean.
Yeah.
And what happens? You get a lot of things. What are the lot of things that you get? You get Lakshmi, you say Ashwasutahars, then you get Alahala, the poison, and eventually you get Amritam also. So that is true of everything in life. Whatever you attempt, something happens only if there is a great degree of churning. Nothing happens with extremely smooth function. I have run a business. I have been a consultant. What is called, what today called disruptive innovation.
Disruptive innovation.
You can't have anything hunky-dory and I'll make it bullshit. It doesn't become beautiful. You're going to churn. When you churn, then this is what happens. There's a churning. And it shows you, bagar, if you're churning, it's not also, you will get all kinds of sweet. No, you will get arahana vasham also. You will get poison also.
You get the good with the bad.
You need partners. And you need get on. So if you look at it in terms of Sanskritam being an amritam, yes, it's an amritam in sense it gives you multiple things, knowing starting from Gopalam Shruti or knowing the meaning of Sahasranamam down to Ayurvedam and
down to the IT industry. IT industry.
IT industry.
Using it as
the best language for computerization,
coding,
this, that, etc.
Yep.
So it is a whole broad spectrum of things that are available. Therefore, it's an amritam. The suggestion that you need put in a lot of effort, honest to God, has not been my experience. Has not been the experience of people like Mahadevan, whoever that you have gone through in this exercise.
Yeah, yeah.
Sure. What's your next question?
Good. That sets me up for the next question. Of course, as all of you can see, Kumar and I share a lot of things. Including not what is on the head, but maybe we use what is inside the head a bit more, right? And of course, our passion for the language and for Sanskrit, but also the irreverent way we have been brought up with English, right? So we've learned to be, I like the way Kumar calls himself the poster boy of Sanskritam. Right, which means you are ready to live in today's world, make it relevant to people today and to younger people. And I know that you have had a great experience with young people, right? I would actually ask you, what made you get in? I mean, what is your primary trigger to become so passionately involved, intoxicated by the Samritam called Sanskrit or Sanskritam?
It's very interesting.
What set you up?
Yeah. There is something called a Friday club we used to have. Every 2 weeks we would meet. Somebody or other will come and talk about something or other. Somebody would come talk about plastic. I spoke about turning around, things like that. The idea was to keep abreast of what is happening by interacting. Then I called a friend of mine called Ganapati Subramaniam, whom I consider a guru. I knew for somebody like GS, I cannot give a talk. So I said, GS, come on, spend an hour with us. So he came over, then he narrated a lot of things. So one of the things that he said was, you know, in near Mayavaram, this is a small village, there's a young boy called Ganapati, who's very smart. So the villagers all put together 2 rupees, 5 rupees, etc., collect some money and send that boy to Calcutta, where a great conference was going on. So this boy went to Calcutta. As usual, he went a little late, got in, the program was, it is on the move, it's happening. So if you look at the next person and say, Koyam Purushaha, who is this man who is speaking? Okay, before the text man could answer, that person felt a little offended. You know, I am organizing, I am everything, and there's a little boy from somewhere and asking, Koyam Purushaha. He said, Guru Kavikola, Guru who? Ambika Dattoham. He said, I am Ambika Datta. This little boy, you know, very young boy, considered knowledgeable. This fellow said, Kavikula Guruhu Dakshinatyaha Ambika Swaputraha Aham Ganeshaha. You are after all Dattuputra. Okay. Whereas I'm Ganesha Aswaputraha. So this dialogue goes on. There's something called Samasya Purana. The challenger will give a shloka, the last two padams of the shloka, and the one who is challenged will have to complete it and make it meaningful. a lot of things like that.
So it is like an antakshari and they have to finish it.
But it is not something that you have inherited. It's something that you do there. Right. Okay. So it went on and on. Subsequently, it found, I said, beautiful. 1,000 years ago, people were speaking Sanskrit fluently. I said, why? It's not 1,000 years ago. This man is called Kadiganta Kanapati Shastri.
Right.
Disciple is Kapali Shastri.
Right.
Kapali Shastri is direct student Shankar Narayan and lives in your street.
Mm-hmm.
I told them. I said, my God, as recently as maybe 100 years ago, people were able to tease each other talking in Sanskrit. So next day I said, forget about Friday Club. I don't want to learn leasing and business. I want to learn Sanskrit. He said, come along. I'll teach you. Went to his house. He took a book, Araswadhyaya or something, Purvasyam Dishi, Surya Haudate or something of that kind. The sun rises on the east. Will you know what happened?
Hmm.
I went for 2 days.
Yeah.
Did not learn anything.
Right.
What do you think I did? I simply deferred my ambition. I said, I will learn Sanskrit. But in the next Janma, I was fairly convinced that I am not going to learn in Janma. Lesser people would have given up forever. The kind of man of determination that I am, I said, I will learn Sanskrit in the next Janma. Don't worry about it. Then what happened was, the same guy, my wife said, there's something called spoken Sanskrit. And then I shared with, something is happening. You know, I had gone to Srirangam. Those boys were playing cricket, were saying something in Sanskrit. Mm-hmm. Then we located this Ganapati Ramachandra. He came, taught us Sanskrit in what is called the spoken Sanskrit format in 10 days, where it starts saying, hello, you let answer some of them. I said, Mama Nama Kumaraha, Bhavataka Nama Kim.
What's your name?
Badato. Mama nama kumaraha. Bhavataka nama kim? Keshav.
Yes.
Shivaramaha. Bhavataka nama kim?
Mama nama Shivaramaha.
Uttamam. Mama nama kumaraha. Aparna. Bhavatyaha nama kim? Unmute krutva vadato.
Mama nama Aparna.
Ah. Aparna. That is how it starts. At the end of day one, the teacher is reciting the story and you understand it completely. You understand it completely. This goes on for 10 days.
Yes.
Great excitement. I said, how come I did not learn this language?
And I know you took that into, another level, the 10-day Sanskrit course, which is now today known as Sanskrit Bharati all over the city and all over the country, I think. I think it started with you.
No,
right? The 10-day format.
I'll come back to you.
Yeah.
The spoken Sanskrit movement started in 1982. Okay. We entered in 1987. Okay. It was there. We are kind of...
As a 10-day course.
I'll tell you how it happened. Because a lot of people enter 10-day spoken Sanskrit classes, feel very encouraged, but don't sustain and learn. What happened was, later, I happened to be in Ganapati Subramanian's house. Ganapati Ramachandran called. Those two chatted because they are both scholars. And then they said, hey, Anna Kumar is here. Tena saka sambhashanam karo. Most people would have spoken English. I am such an arrogant guy. I would not talk to him in English or Tamil. So with what little Sanskrit I knew, I spoke to him.
You fired off.
I fired off. Enough of mistake. Then I organized and then it dawned on me. The way to learn the language is to stay in touch.
Correct.
Nothing more. If you stay in touch, you will learn the language.
Mm.
So it is January 87, my first 10-day Sevram, June 87, second Sevram. At the end of it, the Saptahika Mendam was born.
Mm.
What was the Saptahika Mendam? Every Sunday, 4 to 6, NR Kumar's house, 2 hours, you gather. No communication, no agenda, no notice, no nothing at all. Fixed location, fixed day. Date will not sync with people. 10th, 20th, 30th, it will not. Friday, Sunday, it will sync.
Yeah.
So every Sunday, go to sync. Believe me, no matter what. 7 years it went on day after day after day, week after week after week. People gather, speak in Sanskrit. Okay, that's all. You will talk about the movie that you saw. Somebody will talk about the accident that they saw on the way to Narkoma's residence, or serial. Those days when the two channels. The
you mean all small talk would be in Sanskrit only?
All would be in Sanskrit. In my group, believe me, in this 2 hours, so filled with laughter, you cannot believe it. Okay. Raghavan, will you show the list of participants in that Saptahik Mail now?
Do we have that?
1 second. Yeah, I will show.
Yeah, at this point, I want to welcome Dr. Mahadevan. I think Professor Mahadevan is here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us today.
Is this slide visible to you?
Yes.
It's visible to me. I hope it's visible to
everyone. Yes. Go ahead, tell us.
Okay. Our group consisted of Ganapathy Subramaniam, who was the earlier director of studies of the Costing Institute and practicing management consultant.
Correct.
N.R. Kumar, cost accountant, chartered accountant, turnaround consultant.
Yes.
Manati, cost accountant working for Madras Fertilizers.
Sure.
Hemuji, Hemchandudu, construction contractor.
Of course, I know.
Joseph from Krompet.
Okay.
Who was a small scale industry. Believe me, Joseph was possibly in his 50s or 60s, who drive down all the way from Krompet to my house in Rayapeta for the classes week after week for 7 years. Then there's a bunch of young boys from IIT, I think, or Mahadevan was doing his PhD from AC College. Mm-hmm. Three of them, Murali Krishna, Dr. Mahadevan, now he's here, and Kumar Padmanabhan. These three were from IIT Madras. Then Uma Mahesh and VRS, who are kind of senior to us in Sanskrit, they were already running Shibirams and all that. They just finished their degree and they're running around giving their parents a lot of concern. What is this bugger going to do? That kind of phase they were there. Just finished their graduate.
Mm-hmm.
And I had Bhavani Shankar Bahadur. Can you imagine who Bhavani Shankar Bahadur is?
Well, I'm guessing he was from Nepal, and I can imagine his vocation. I can imagine his vocation from his name.
Okay, you imagine. Well, he was a watchman in the TNEB in Rayapeta High Road.
Right.
We had a Shibiram in Gaudiya Mat, P.K. Srinivasan ran a Shibiram. He was a student there. Believe me, he was the only person who survived from that Shibiram, from Gaudiya Mat, and he was a part of a group. And the only... So if you notice, G.S., N.R.K., Marathi, Hemuji, Joseph, Murali Krishna, Mahadevan, Kumar, Umamesh, V.R.S., I've left out the name, Dr. T.V. Subramaniam, very highly respected management trader, a botany professor, Kumar, I think, from Madras University. There may be 10, 12 people. They were essential features. For none of them, Sanskrit was their occupation. None of them, Sanskrit was their occupation. Venugopal is the exception. Venugopal was the Vyakaranam student, Shiromani student from Madras Sanskrit College. So this is the kind of group that we met. And it made all the difference. Maybe Mahadevan, can you share what do you feel about
it? I would definitely love to hear Professor Mahadevan. Welcome to the evening.
Thank you, and thank you all. I must thank Keshav and N.R. Kumar for this wonderful opportunity to hear from all of you. Of course, share a few things. Kumar just took me back by 40 years, I think. 30 years, whatever. 1987. And to put things in a nutshell, I was doing my PhD at IIT Madras, and I ran into the same camp Shibir which Kumar attended, which happened in PS College, PS Senior Secondary, PS School, I think.
In Mylapore, PS
Senior Secondary. So that's where this Ganapathy Ramachandran's, this study. I had the same experience. On day three, we were able to write three sentences. In fact, by the way, I had absolutely no background on Sanskrit. Right. Except that, my mother used to teach me some shlokas. So faithfully, I recite those shlokas. So there is this dhwani, familiarity of the sound, I must say. Little bit I was able to read, not very, it was difficult. That was the background with which I enter into this whole thing. Yeah. So I attend this 1 week program, 10-day program. It revolutionizes your thinking. Mm. I must tell you that Sanskrit is the reason I think we all love Sanskrit, and I have covered a lot of ground. God has been kind to me. Mm. I now give a whole day program for Sanskrit vice chancellors in the country in Sanskrit. I try to do a 1-day strategy workshop in Sanskrit for the Sanskrit vice chancellor. All that I do, all because of this. But the charm behind, or the secret behind all this, I must tell you, is I don't think any of us, all that he mentioned, this group, none of us approached it as approaching a language.
Mm.
The sense that I need to learn Sanskrit.
Yeah.
I think there was some magnet in it, which simply absorbed us into it. We were able to see that dimension of Sanskrit. Sanskrit is very unique. My own personal experience is it changes your worldview. It's not about language. It just changes your worldview. Your understanding of the world changes by its very structure, by its the way it has constructed itself and presented it before us. I'll give you a couple of examples.
Please.
You know, see, if you have to say see, right? I see somebody.
Yes.
So there are about 30 words probably in Sanskrit to, you know, communicate this.
Communicate.
Lochra darshane is one dhatu. Lokra darshane is another dhatu.
Mm-hmm.
So one can get the idea of seeing from two dhatus now. From loch, you get lochana, which is the instrument for seeing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. From lokra, you get loka, which is the loka, object that you can
world.
See. The object that you can see. You say, my world is different from your world. We keep using these kinds of words. So this kind of ideas are aplenty. The language is not filling your vocabulary. This is my experience. The language is not simply filling your vocabulary. It is actually constructing your worldview. It constantly gives you a lens. That lens is refreshingly very different. This was my first experience. Second experience is what is so charming about this 10-day spoken Sanskrit program. As a teacher, I can reflect it much more strongly today, even though I felt it at that time, is what attracted me was a methodology of teaching a language was far appealing. As Kumara was saying, you can go to a Vyakarana Pandit and then after a few days, you'll run off forever in your lifetime. I think I learned actually how to learn a language. So I could learn Malayalam a little bit when I went to Cochin as a vice chancellor for a couple of years.
Correct.
I could, today I'm able to pick up languages because that is what it taught. That is the power of Sanskrit language, partly the power of Sanskrit Bharati also. So I think Sanskrit is a great possibility which broad bases our understanding of ourselves and the worldview. Fills our perspectives and reality in a way which I don't know how to describe. That's one part of it. The other part is this N.R. Kumar's house. It's very important to know that. I allude to what he say. See, what happens is, you know, we learn Sanskrit. We are all Arambashuraha. You know, there is a lot of genuine interest. Let's all go and then do a 10-day spoken.
Oh, yes. Initial interest and enthusiasm.
I think genuinely all those are interested. I don't think anybody is uninterested. All of them are interested. I can see it on their face. What really happens is after the 10 days, slowly the curve starts coming down for want of an opportunity to do something about it. So in our model, you know, of that we all went through, we did two, three things. And today we have a vaccination. After 6 weeks, you have a booster dose. That's exactly what we did. We did a 10-day program. Then what N.R. Kumar and a few...
And then every 7 days you went.
No. They will take us to a place 40 kilometers from away to a farmhouse.
Guduanjiri.
They will take away all our belongings which are in the foreign language. So morning, if you want a cup of coffee, better ask in Sanskrit. Otherwise, you don't get coffee. If you want to have your food, you better ask what you want in Sanskrit. So in 3 days, like I have attended three such camps. You go orders of magnitude in your understanding of this line. These are booster doses. This is the second dose and the third dose and so on. Mm. And then the last thing is this wonderful Lakshmipuram camp. Mm. You have 2 hours. you don't have to ask anyone, you know which room to go. I'm sure there is somebody there. If nobody's there, you can talk to the wall in Sanskrit and then come back. that created the last piece that you required. I think we are all very eternally grateful to him for what he did for the cast of
Sanskrit. Was that something Kumar himself designed, or was it part of the original?
No, it was Kumar's. It was Kumar's innovation.
So he created a satsang atmosphere every 7 days where you meet and you exchange.
Very neat innovation. Zero innovation. Admin. Fixed day, fixed time, fixed location. If you're trying to do something, don't even offer coffee. So let me offer coffee the first time. Zero overhead. Come talk. That's the format in which you did it. I want to add something about the Guduanjari camps that Dr. Mahadevan mentioned.
Okay.
That, you know, Mahadevan, what is the transformation that takes place?
Yeah.
We were all speaking fluent Sanskrit by the time we entered Guduanjari camp. But when you stay there for 3 full days, morning to evening, fortunately, pre-mobile days, even then, nothing was, you know, we were so bloody obsessive. Somebody referred to me as a fanatic or something.
Yeah.
So what we did was, we removed everything. No Hindu, no Tamil paper, no nothing at all.
Yeah.
That way, you are soaked in Sanskrit through the day.
Okay.
What actually happens is, from talking in Sanskrit, you graduate thinking in Sanskrit.
Right.
So that is the important change that takes place when you, in a 3-4 days residency.
Well, before we carry on, you know, there are 40 people apart from the two of you here.
Ah, I didn't realize that. Good.
Yeah. And 40 of you don't know that Professor Mahadevan, who's talking to you, has been at IIM Bangalore and has also been Vice Chancellor of the Chennai Vishwavidyapeeth. Right? And all of that, now to be the head of an institution like Chennai Vishwavidyapeeth, which is a global position you're holding. How much passion must have been incited from that little camp or whatever he spoke about? What a life-turning event it would. Of course, being a professor at IIM is a privilege and an honor for anybody, but you can do it in English all your life. But to head an institution like the Vishwavidyapeeth is really, I think, the litmus test for somebody like Professor Mahadevan, and the passion that must have really manifest itself in later life. So I'd like you to actually say a few words about what you think is this globalness of Sanskrit that you have experienced, and where is it heading in terms of the world stage? Just a short little insight.
Raghavan, will you get on the Pride of India screens?
Yes.
Hey, can you do something?
I think you can stop spotlighting.
Aparna is there. Keshav, we did, in the course of this period, we did a play on Guru Gobind Singh.
Yes.
I think I'll tell you, and one of the kids who participated in the Guru Gobind Singh play is there.
Is here today.
She's here today, Aparna Nandiyar. I'll quickly
spotlighting, I'd like you to spotlight the people who are speaking, especially Professor Mahadevan when he was speaking. We could have had him on spotlight. And now, of course, if Aparna is speaking, we can have her on spotlight.
Hey, bring Aparna Nandiyar on.
Yeah.
It happened something like this.
Great. Aparna, would you like to say
Khalistan moment?
Yeah.
I think Srinivasan is sharing his screen with this video image. It would be nice if we can exit screen sharing. Mr. Srinivasan, please. Then we can bring the other people on spotlight.
Yeah, is it? Oh, I see. Is it NSS?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. No, Srinivasan. Srinivasan by, I mean, I don't know how that happened. Sorry. We'll go back to our own controls. Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Now, this is the days of Khalistan movement. There used to be the Sanskrit camp, Sanskrit classes, 10-day classes. I land up wherever a class was getting conducted anywhere in Chennai.
Correct.
And we used to narrate stories here, there, Sagara Putra, all those stories. Then what I started doing was, I started narrating stories of, essentially, of Tegh Bahadur Singh's life and Guru Gobind Singh's life.
Okay.
Because I felt so strongly about, you know, this, the feeling that as though Hinduism and Sikhism are very different or against each other or something. So I wanted people to understand the kind of sacrifice that has taken place in the protection of Hinduism by the Sikh gurus. I used to share it. And Hemuji, a friend of ours who was a part of Saptahiki, said, Kumar, you recited so much passion. Why don't you make it into a play? And I'll give you a forum. Tejo Mayananda, Chinmaya, UFA is coming to Chennai. So we'll have a meet in Chinmaya Mission School or Chinmaya office in Harrington Road. Most people would have thought twice. I've never learned to think twice at all. I had no idea. It's not as though I could. I said, okay, we'll do it. But the Saptahiki Mandal is a great resource base. So I narrated two stories. I don't know whether Mahadevan remembers. I narrated two stories. Tegh Bahadur's life, one story. Guru Gobind Singh's life, another story. My own preference was Tegh Bahadur Singh's life. But everybody says Guru Gobind Singh's story is more appealing. It's how Aurangzeb's man had captured Guru Gobind Singh's two sons, Zarawar Singh and whatever the other boy's name. And they're blackmailing Guru Gobind Singh. Guru Gobind Singh, forget about it. And those two kids were buried. That's the story. So how did it begin? My first daughter, Rukmini, became Aurangzeb. My second daughter, Radha, became Sarovar Singh. Her friends, Aparna, it is this 7-8 kids from Lakshmipuram and 2-3 kids from elsewhere. I think the oldest was possibly Ram Kumar, who was in 10th standard or 9th standard or something. The youngest was, my daughter, who was in 3rd standard or something of that kind. So every morning I'll go up, think something of a scene. I knew the last scene. These two kids will be buried alive. I did not know any of the intermediate. Ram Kumar was in 10th standard or 9th standard. Pardon?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead.
So we will. I'll write something. Come down, show it to my daughter, and say, "Appa, zustay ille." That's all. I know what you understand, but what I understood is not good enough. So it slowly evolved. Believe me, we went to Chinmaya Mission.
Put up the show.
Put up the show. We were supposed to do it after Swami Tejomananda spoke. Tejomananda said, "Let me see the play first." Raghavan, will you show the images?
Yeah, I'll show the images.
Once. Okay. Tejo said, we'll first see the play and then I'll talk later. I don't know what Tejo was intended to talk when we finished the play. Tejo talked only about the play. Nothing else. Aparna. Aparna, you were one of Guru Gobind Singh's shishyas?
That's right, Mama.
Okay, you share your experience. I tend to think of them as kids. Okay, this is the kid I was talking about. Aparna, tell me for the impact of what your experience with Guru Gobind Dharma.
Aparna, welcome to, share your experiences, please.
Thank you. So I was literally raised in Kumar Mama's house.
Can we spotlight Aparna, please? Yeah.
He called her.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can. Go ahead.
Yes, I was literally raised in Kumar Mama's house. I would just go back to my house for sleeping. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how my life was. And that's when I think the seed for spirituality, the love for language was sown so deeply ingrained. Mm-hmm. So I did the Sambhashanam 10-day course. But like most others, I kind of weaned out of it once I moved out of the place. But the foundation that I got there in terms of the act, the drama that we did, and the 4 to 6 Sunday evenings that Mama was talking about, that kids would be playing around there and we would listen to the conversations that they were having, sometimes be a part of the conversation too, right?
Correct.
So that had a profound impact in the way I was thinking, in the way I kind of grew up beyond that, right? And then when my kid started learning Bhagavad Gita, is when I had my the second realization, I would say, that I had more experiences in life that I could relate to as a second innings, right?
Yeah.
When we were taught Gita when we were too young, it was just a shloka that parents or somewhere else they would teach, which is when I started appreciating and connecting to everything that happened to me way back in Kumar Mama's house. Good. One of that being the drama, right? So when we were young, there weren't too many of these Amar Chitra Katha books, or we had very limited access to all of that, even if they were there.
So it had to be from
each other. Yeah, it had to be from each other and through plays like this, right?
Yeah.
And this play had a very profound impact in terms of, I couldn't get my head around how somebody could be so determined for a cause that they were even willing to sacrifice their children. Right? It was scary at that point in time. Hey, are my parents so determined at some point in their life? Do they have some, you know, conviction about something that they're really okay sacrificing their kids' life? But when you grow up and you start to understand the beauty of it, that was a very limited dose, right? Now my kid reads a lot of Amar Chitra Kathas, so it's very diluted. So they learn tons of things, right? For us, it was just one thing, right? We had just that one thing in mind that was sticking, right? We enjoyed playing the drama as kids, right? And we enjoyed traveling together. That's something rare those days that you know, picnics also happen within Chennai. So we could go out of Chennai, and then we were doing something very useful. Parents were very happy because we are learning something new, something useful, and we were in the right hands. We were with the right people.
Yeah, so you were learning the right values. I think that we can all relate with that because we grew up like that, and the world is rapidly changing. So, in fact, I wanted to thank you, Aparna, and of course, ask Kumar. You know, this you've done so many things. In fact, not many people know that your sister is a Padma Awardee, Shanti Ranganathan.
Yeah.
Right? Your family is just so extended, and Lakshmipuram had something special about that place, right?
True.
The work you did, the kind of things all of you did as young people.